welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving show by the not-really-mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to episode 120. I have had a lot of email in the last few weeks, and I wanted to catch up with everybody, do a little bit of a podcast on some substantive stuff, as well as let everybody know where I'm with the podcast. Now, I received a lot of emails, and if I don't mention your topic that you sent me in this podcast, please feel free to send it again. If you're a Patreon supporter, you could send it on Patreon, and they have priority for a subject. If you're not a Patreon supporter, you can send it in the Facebook group. You could send it through Facebook Messenger. Just let me know that you've sent it. And if you want to email me, you can email me at gpyb.com@gmail.com. It's two .coms. A lot of people leave off the first .com because it's kind of weird. And I don't even know if you're allowed to do that anymore, but this was a legacy email from way back when Gmail first started. You need an invitation to join Gmail, and it was this whole secret club kind of thing, and now everybody in the world now has Gmail. I don't know how that happened. Anyway. One of my Facebook group members wanted to suggest that I do interviews with people that use the program, not just for a breakup, but for other situations in life, which is an excellent, excellent idea. And I have spent hours, and when I say hours, I mean 5 to 8 hours a day for a few weeks now, trying to figure out how to get two voices on Zoom to sound the same in the podcast softwares that I use. I think I've mentioned another time where I did an interview and I was really excited to have someone come on the podcast. And one of my listeners came on and we did about an hour interview. It was really lovely and she was quite a proponent of the program. She also had a lot of good suggestions for newcomers, and I really liked the interview, but I couldn't get the two voices, mine and hers, to sound right for the podcast, for releasing the podcast. No matter what I did, nothing sounded right. So that interview has never been published, and I feel bad about it because the person was expecting that they would hear themselves on the podcast, and that didn't happen. So I have spent weeks, because I really do want people to come on the podcast and talk about the program, talk about their life, talk about what's helpful, what's not helpful. And so I have done a lot of testing, so much testing, it's ridiculous. And it was pushing the next release, this release of the podcast, back and back and back, and it was making me crazy. I've also gotten a lot of emails about boot camps, a lot. I'm starting an advanced boot camp in a couple of weeks for those who have had a boot camp with me before. I don't like to run boot camps unless I can read journals and be available every day to my boot campers. And up until now, I haven't had that luxury because of my medical schedule. But that's easing up and should continue to ease up each week. So I will be doing an advanced boot camp in a couple of weeks. I'll announce it in the Facebook group. And I'm announcing it here. And it's first come, first served. And I know that I had a lot of people that were interested and will continue to be interested. And I love boot camps, and I love the growth that I see in boot camps. So I'm really excited about boot camps, but I have to be available to my boot campers. And if I'm not, I get very upset about it because I think that that's what they deserve. They deserve to have access to me every day if they need it. And I read their journals, and I make sure that they're doing self-care. And I don't like to get behind on boot camp messages or journals or anything. So I haven't done a boot camp yet, but my medical schedule is easing up. So I will be starting an advanced boot camp sometime in May. And I will tell you where the information for the advanced boot camp is. And you can go to gpybbootcamps.com. And I will put up the information about the advanced boot camp, but you have to have had a boot camp with me before. Even if you had an advanced boot camp with me before, you can do one again. But it's difficult to explain to people who haven't had a boot camp how they work. So for this one, for me on my way back, I'm only going to have people that have had a boot camp with me before. Now, the basic boot camp, I hope to start in June. And summer boot camps are always a lot of fun. So if you're interested in the basic boot camp, just send me an email and I'll make sure that you're on the list. Anyway, another thing that's been in my email, I got a flurry of emails that have to do with the Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial. And one thing that I want people to know is that I followed the UK trial very closely. And at the time, my disclaimer right now is that I haven't followed the US trial, the defamation trial. But I'm an attorney, I'm a therapist, and I'm a domestic violence survivor. And people have asked me to weigh in on this. When I followed the UK trial, I almost came out and said I didn't believe Amber Heard. But because he's so high profile, and I didn't want anybody to think that I was some sort of Johnny Depp fangirl. And I've never been a fangirl for really anybody. I've never seen any of the pirate movies. I really liked his early stuff. I loved 21 Jump Street. I liked Edward Scissorhands, all those early things that he did. But I've never really thought much about Johnny Depp. But I didn't really want to say anything like I didn't believe her, but I really didn't. I listened to the things that she recorded, and she recorded a lot of him. And it was clear that he was drunk or he was high and he was slamming cabinets and he was yelling at her. But what I heard wasn't my idea of abuse. When my mother started slamming cabinets, she had a borderline personality disorder. And if she started slamming cabinets and yelling, you know that you were going to get the crap beat out of you as soon as she was done slamming cabinets. So when I was listening to Johnny Depp, I was thinking he's going to beat the hell out of her, and she called him abusive, that there would be some evidence of that. But I didn't hear that in the UK trial. And I didn't say anything because I wasn't sure if something was going to come out. I didn't want people to accuse me of being taken by his fame or whatever. And I'm just not taken by fame. I've had clients who are famous. I've had non-clients who are famous. I know a lot of famous people. And I've even had clients whose exes have become involved with famous people. And I've learned a lot of stuff about a lot of people that I would never say out loud, but I'm just not really taken by anyone's fame and fortune. But somebody was writing me and saying that these different things were coming out in the U.S. trial that I don't remember coming out in the U.K. trial. And somebody said that at the trial, it came out, and I don't know how true any of this is because I haven't followed the trial, but I will. I will do a podcast on it. I'm throwing this out there because if you have questions, if you're following the trial and you have questions, I want you to send them to me, whether they're legal, whether they're psychological, whether it's about domestic violence, whatever it is, I can answer those questions. So send them to me, and I will do a podcast or more on the U.S. trial as soon as I have some time to follow it, which I haven't because I've been doing all of this audio stuff, which I hate. But somebody else wrote me and said that Johnny Depp had a mother who had had suicide attempts and that Amber Heard had threatened suicide if he divorced her, and therefore he stayed. Now, if you remember, I did a podcast on Travis Alexander and Ryan Poston, the two gentlemen who are now dead, because they stayed in touch with their crazy ex-girlfriends, Jodi Arias and Shani Ubers, both of who threatened suicide if they broke up with them. And I'll put a link to the episode that I talked about Travis Alexander and Ryan Poston on the YouTube version of this podcast. I'll put a link to the episode because I don't remember what episode it was off the top of my head. I also did an article in it where I talked about Travis and Ryan grew up very, very differently. Travis Alexander grew up with two drug addict parents. He was homeless for a while. He was bullied in school because I guess he wasn't clean when he was with his parents. He didn't have nice clothes. And then his grandmother saved him from the parents, but he had a very rough childhood for quite a while. Ryan, on the other hand, had a very charmed childhood. He came from a very loving family, very well-to-do. And each of these men wound up with crazy girlfriends, Jody Arias and Shady Hubris, and each of them stayed in touch with these lunatics because the lunatics would threaten suicide if they cut them off. And I always say, if somebody threatens suicide, it's not your job to keep them alive. It's their job. They need to go to therapy. They need to get some help. And if somebody threatens suicide, you need to tell them, I'm going to call somebody that they know, a parent, a relative, a sister, a brother, a friend, and I'm going to tell them what you're saying, and they'll get you some help. Or I'll call 911. But you don't stay with these crazy people. Jody Arias mutilated Travis Alexander. She butchered this guy. She stabbed him. She slit his throat. She shot him. And the anger that came out was just horrible. And she made up all this baloney on the stand about how he was grabbing at her and stuff. She's so full of crap. And Shani Hubers, on the other hand, she went to Ryan's apartment. And he was a gun enthusiast and probably never thought that anybody would be able to kill him because he had guns everywhere. If you see his apartment, there were just guns everywhere. And she picked up one of his guns and she shot him. So you know, just because you're a gun enthusiast or a gun owner and you've got guns everywhere doesn't mean that you're particularly safe. So I've already done that podcast and I will discuss it. And I'll discuss the effect that people who attempt suicide or threaten to attempt suicide have on other people. But I'm telling you, it's not your place to keep someone else alive. It's just not. And if somebody decides they're going to off themselves because you're breaking up with them and you need to break up with them for your own sanity, let them deal with it with their therapist, with their family, with somebody, but you don't have to stay hostage to somebody who's threatening suicide. So I'm going to listen to that part of the Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial and talk more about that. But if you have questions about this trial, send them to me because people have sent me little snippets about things that have come out in the trial and I haven't looked at them very closely because I haven't followed the trial. I'm trying to get the podcast in better shape. I invested in a little more equipment and I want to thank my Patreon supporters for that, but I still need more and I'm moving along. I just wanted to say that if you have a topic that you want me to talk about, and it's not interviews with people that have been doing the program, or it's not Amber Heard and Johnny Depp, and you've sent me email, please send it again. I have a few other things that I want to talk about on this podcast, and I have two clients who remind me very much of each other, and I have other clients that have been involved in relationships with people that are what I term to be commitment phobic. But I'm going to talk about these two women. They're both very attractive ladies. One is in her 50s and one is in her 40s. They're both incredibly attractive. They both have great personality, good sense of humor. They were both wonderful mothers. One is still raising her kids. The other, her kids are grown. She even has grandkids. She's a wonderful mother, a wonderful grandmother. They are both have great senses of humor. They both are executives in their respective fields. They're both very well to do. And each of them came to me after breakup with a narcissist. One, I think, is borderline sociopathic. And one came and did a boot camp with me, and the other just became a client. And we worked together once a week for a year or so. And I worked with each of them. And then when they were ready, they started dating again. And they both took time off from relationships and from dating. And then after that, they went back out there. They started seeing guys who were okay, but they weren't personality disordered. They weren't big jerk-offs or anything like that. But they weren't really lighting these ladies' worlds on fire. And then each of them met a guy that they were just kind of over the moon about. And neither of these guys were personality disordered. They were both what I call commitment phobic. And I have to say that I've said this on other podcasts. When I get out of abusive relationships with personality disordered crazy people, my next step was the commitment phobia. I was in a few relationships with people who couldn't or wouldn't commit. And it wasn't that they wouldn't eventually commit, but they wouldn't commit at the point where I knew them. Sometimes if you're with a commitment phobe, you just catch them at the wrong time. Sometimes they're never going to commit to somebody, and other times they're either still in love with their ex, or they got really burned, or and they still need time to get over it. And I've talked about how Michael thought that he was never going to be in a relationship again. He was never going to be in a serious relationship. He said he was never getting married again. And when he met me, like, that all went out the window. And the woman who was seeing him before me was really, really upset when she found out that we got engaged and then we got married. I mean, she was just really upset because he had told her, like, he was done with relationships. So sometimes that happens. But he said to me, Michael said to me, he said, I thought I'd fallen in love before, but if this is what love is, then I've never been in love before now. I mean, he was just over the moon about me. And like I said, the lady that was in a relationship with him before me was just beside herself. I mean, I said, I thought I was going to be a boiled bunny on my stove one day when I came home from work, because she was sending him letters and she was just acting really crazy. And I could see how all the things he said to her, and then in the face of how our relationship went, it just made her crazy. But anyway, if you go out with somebody who's in like their 40s or 50s and they've never had a long-term relationship, or in one of my clients' case, the guys told her that he had intimacy difficulties and he had been married before. But what she did, and I say you should never do this, and she and I have had a few conversations about this. She heard him when he said he had intimacy difficulties. So what she did, and she sort of did this with the narcissist / sociopath that she had been involved with for years, was accommodate this disability. And if you have been in a relationship and you have difficulty with intimacy, that's a disability, and you need to go to therapy, not just parade around and tell people that you're disabled. You need to go to therapy and fix it. She recognized his inability to be truly intimate, so she wouldn't call him. She hadn't heard from him for a few days. She wouldn't chase him, and she had a life. You know, that was one of the things that I tell people all the time. You have to have a life. But if you want to talk to the person that you're seeing, you should be able to. I mean, you should be able to pick up the phone or text or say, hey, how you doing? But she wanted to leave him alone. She wouldn't chase him. She did all the things that you would think, okay, if I do this, he's going to run away. So she wouldn't do any of those things. She would just let him be. But you have to be honest with yourself. If there's a good chance that if someone has intimacy difficulties and they're with you for a few months, there's always going to be an expiration date. If someone is a commitment phobe, there's always an expiration date after a few months. And it has nothing to do with what you do, what you don't do. It has to do with them. And if they're starting to feel feelings for you, like falling in love, they will just beat the hell out of there. And it's nothing that you did wrong. And that's the thing that these two wonderful women who are clients of mine can't seem to figure out. Like, who wouldn't want them? They were in this relationship with these guys. They're very wonderful women. They had really good relationships with these gentlemen, and yet it didn't work out. Think about the closer you get to somebody and you're having fun and you're getting along and you're clicking on so many levels and you're thinking to yourself, because I've been there, been here, done this, you're thinking to yourself, who wouldn't want this? Like, this is happiness. This is fun. This is just an awesome time. Why would you want to be miserable? And I've been in this relationship, and several of my clients have been in this relationship from anywhere from 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. And honestly, several of my clients have had this relationship where the guy just seems over the moon about you, and they're gushing about how much fun they have with you and how great you are and blah, blah, blah. And then the next thing you know, they're walking away. And you're like, who wouldn't like this? Who wouldn't want a time like this that's wonderful. And you're falling in love. You're having a grand old time and they're getting cold feet. And you're like, what are you talking about? And they're like, oh, I gotta go. And you're like, why? Why are you going? What's wrong with you? We're having so much fun. And I've talked about this. I have videos on it where I was with this guy and we just clicked on every level. And we would spend an entire weekend together from Friday night through Sunday night. And we just had a ball and we'd go see friends. And he would say to me on Saturday, we would do some chores around his house. We'd go shopping. And then we'd go out and see friends. And he would say to me, let's go out and see and be seen. And it was like really funny. We'd be laughing. We'd be carrying on. And we would be getting closer and closer and closer. And he had an ex-girlfriend that he broke up with a couple of months before he met me. And they were always fighting and always disagreeing. She made him miserable. By the end of our weekend together, he would be floating out to sea talking to her again. And I would be crushed because we just spent 48 hours together. We had nothing but good times and laughed and joked and carried on. And then he'd be fighting with her for the whole of Sunday night. And I'd be going home miserable. And I've talked about this in different articles and videos. And I talked about, like, we were laughing once. We were in a diner. It was like 10 o'clock on a Saturday night. And we were just roaring. We were just doing a lot of banter back and forth. And we were laughing so hard. We were just clicking off each other. And he was laughing so hard, he was crying. And he had tears in his eyes. And he reached across the table and he grabbed my hand. And he said, I love you. And I was just over the moon about that. And by the next day, he was completely pulling away. And he was on his way to his ex-girlfriend to play footsie with her for a while. And just be completely nuts. She just made him miserable. And I was friends with a couple of his friends because that's how we met. We ran in the same crowd. And his friends would say to me, I have no idea why he talks to her. She's such a terrible person. And one guy said to me that she had the personality of a flea. And another guy was like, I guess she wore really red lipstick all the time. And he would call her clown lips. And I've talked about this before, but his best friend was like, oh, she's got these clown lips. And I don't know what he sees in her. That would bother me when his two closest friends would come to me and say, I have no idea why he's with her or why he wants to spend any time with her when he's got you. But if you commit and you don't want to get close to somebody who's good for you, who's good to you, he and I just had a rip-roaring good time, and I felt great about it. I just wanted to be closer, but it made him crazy. It was too close. When you're arguing with somebody who makes you miserable, it's keeping them at a distance. When I was in that relationship, I wanted to be with him all the time because we had so much fun. We got along so well, and I always said that I really like guys that play on words, and he had so many different play on words, and he was so funny. I had been in some relationships where I had been traumatized, where they had triggered my trauma, my abandonment issue, and I would go crazy, and I would isolate, and I would be the crazy ex-girlfriend, the crazy girlfriend, where I'd be like, get away from me. But when I was in the relationship with commitment phobes where I felt good all the time, it didn't trigger my abandonment or my trauma. And then they would pull away, and my abandonment would just go off the charts, and I'd be off to the races. So when I was in these relationships, I mean, I just remember I want to get over it. I really didn't. And I remember I would be getting off. I would think about it, and then I'd be getting off the highway to go to work, and I'd be like, okay, I have to zip up. I have to put all this shit away. And I realized I had to take a look at my previous relationships, my parents, my relationship with my father. My father was emotionally unavailable, but there were things about him that I really cared about. And in the last few years, I've wished that my parents were around so I could ask them questions that I never asked them when they were around. But with both my clients find that when someone's not so disordered that you can look at them and say, oh my God, like you're a narcissist, you're a sociopath, you're like paranoid personality disorder, you've got craziness like coming out of your ears, it's hard to let go. I understand that. You could do everything right with the commitment phobes. and you know that you're not going to be a burden, you're not going to be the crazy girlfriend, you're not going to be this, you're not going to be that, but it's not you. And I try to explain that to the people that are clients of mine that I get involved with. You try to do everything, you know, to be the perfect girlfriend, the perfect boyfriend, but that's not what they're reacting to. They're not reacting to what you're doing on the outside. They're reacting to what they're feeling on the inside. So when you're feeling all warm and cozy about them, like you've had a great day, you've had so much fun, everything's great, you think, like, who wouldn't want to go home at night and feel this warm and cozy? And I'll tell you who wouldn't want it. A commitment phobe wouldn't want it. They start to feel horribly uncomfortable. It has nothing to do with you, except you're so great. They know it and they walk away. Because you're so great, because you're so wonderful, you're like, okay, I'm out of here. And there's nothing you can do about it because you're the person that they care about and they don't want to care about somebody. They're afraid of being hurt. When someone says, I have intimacy difficulties, it means they're afraid of being hurt. So when they start to feel warm and cozy about you and they start to realize that you're the greatest thing since the folded napkin, even though you've given them every indication that you would never, ever hurt them, you wouldn't do anything, you wouldn't crowd their space, done everything that you think you should do if you are with somebody who has intimacy difficulties, it doesn't matter. It's what's going on inside them. They're feeling vulnerable. They're feeling passion toward you. They're feeling like you are the greatest thing since the folded napkin. And they don't want folded napkins. They want to wipe their mouth on their sleeve. They want to run out the door. That's what they want. And that's what they do. And you can sit there and look at everything about your relationship, everything that you love, every single episode that you've had with him or her, and you're looking at it and you're going, this was such a great day and that was such a great day. Oh, we had so much fun doing this. We had so much fun doing that. And you're thinking, like, this is such a great relationship. For me, I was like, oh, we laughed all day long. And you're thinking, who wouldn't want this? And I remember with the guy that I'm talking about, we went leaf peeping in October. We hit every New England state. And one day we left Rhode Island, we went up to Massachusetts, we went to New Hampshire, Vermont, we went into Maine, we were up at this mountaintop in Maine, it was just gorgeous. And then we came down to Connecticut and back up into Rhode Island. We did every New England state. We were laughing. And one of the first stops that we made was on the beach, on the ocean in New Hampshire. And we were standing on the beach. It was this very cold, windy day because we were leaf peeping in October. And the ocean was just magnificent. I mean, the waves were just huge and crashing on the beach. It was amazing. And we're standing on the beach. We're the only people on this beach. And he came up behind me and he put his arms around me under my jacket. And we just stood there. And he put his head on my shoulder and we watched the waves. And it was the first time he really got physical with me, like he held me. And it was very early when we knew each other. We met in August and we had been friends. And, you know, I thought that there was a click there. But this day that we went leaf peeping was the first time that things started to get a little physical. I crushed on him a bit, but I just thought that we were friends. So we did this on a Saturday and we came back and we went to his house. I was exhausted. I mean, I was absolutely exhausted. And I only lived like 20 minutes from him. He lived in Providence and I lived in Warwick, Rhode Island. And I just couldn't think about driving anymore. And he had done a lot of driving. And I stayed over at his house and we had been spending like every weekend together. And we spent the night together, and it was not good. It was not a good coupling, let me put it that way. It just, it wasn't good. So I was like, well, that sucked. And the next weekend, I went to his house on a Saturday morning, and he was like, I can't do this. And it was because we spent the night together the week before, and we hadn't talked about it. So we broke up. I mean, we're in a relationship, you know, in like an 8-hour period, and then we broke up. And then a month later, we sort of drifted back to each other. And that's what would happen. Like we'd be in a crowd and we'd see each other and we'd kind of look across the room and we would have a lot of the same jokes and things like that. And And then I saw him on Thanksgiving, and my kids were at their father's, and I was having a really hard time. And he was having a hard time. It was his first Thanksgiving without his girlfriend. And we spent Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday together, the whole 4 days of Thanksgiving weekend. And we didn't do anything. And on Sunday, he asked me if I wanted to stay over. And I was like, are you sure? Like, you sure that you want to do this? And I stayed, and it was wonderful. And we had like this intimacy that was just great. It wasn't like the first time. It was really, really wonderful. And then the phone rang, and it was his ex-girlfriend. And I'm throwing my clothes on and running out the door. And this is what would happen. And we had spent 4 days together. Every single minute of every single day, we laughed, we joked, we had a great time. And then on Sunday, we were in bed, and then the phone rang, and it was her. And he was off to the races with her, and I was just, I gotta go. And he's walking me to the car, and he's kissing me, and he's saying, I love you. And I'm like, I can't do this anymore. I just can't do this anymore. And it was ridiculous. And so I didn't see him again until January. And then he called me, and he said, I want you to come over. He had moved, and he was in a new place. And he says, we're going to have a relationship. It's going to be great. And I've decided that you're the one I want to be with, and I want you to come over, and we're going to talk about our relationship, and we're going to talk about everything, and we're going to get this thing going once and for all. And I was like, okay. And I knew that he had been in therapy. I'd been in therapy. Both of our therapists had been going a little nuts about this relationship. And I know that most of his friends have been working on him to try to get him to figure this stuff out. They were all on my side. They were like, you got to get rid of your miserable ex-girlfriend. So I told all my friends, I'm going over there, and we're going to talk about our relationship, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that. And I was over there maybe a couple of hours. We were sitting on the couch, and we're talking to each other, and then the phone rang, and it was his ex-girlfriend. I was like, how does she always know that I'm here? It was like there was this spy somewhere. I had no idea how this worked. I had no idea if she was calling him every night or she was just calling him when I was there. But he got all confused again. And I was like, you gotta be kidding me. You have got to be kidding me. And he said, you can spend the night here, but we're not going to do anything. We're just going to sleep in the same bed. And, you know, that didn't happen. I mean, we did sleep in the same bed, but it wasn't like nothing was going to happen. Something happened. And then he was all freaked out about that. And I'm like, you know, you got to grow up, dude. I mean, we were like 32, 33 at the time. I was like, dude, like, you got to grow up. And as I'm leaving, he's walking me to my car, and he's saying, I'm so grateful for you. I love you so much, blah, blah, blah. And I absolutely adored him, but I never went back. I was just like, I can't do this anymore. And this is like what when my clients come to me and they tell me about these kinds of relationships, and my clients are all incredibly worthwhile people who deserve a partner who loves them and cares about them and who isn't a coward when it comes to being in a relationship and giving someone a commitment. And a commitment phobe will always deny that anything was as good as you believe they were, because they're distancing themselves over and over and over again. And when they return to a relationship that doesn't work, that makes them miserable, it's good for them because they are emotionally distant and they don't have to feel those feelings about, oh my God, this woman makes me feel so good about myself and I'm falling in love and all that stuff that they just don't want to deal with. It's easier for them to end a relationship with someone that they really care about and they have such a great time with and return to somebody who makes them crazy or want to return to somebody who makes them crazy because they're working out their issues with that person. And you don't give them the opportunity to work out their issues, to behave their issues, because they would rather be with somebody who makes them not, but they don't want to deal with therapy. They don't want a straightforward resolution to their issues. They refuse to take ownership of their issues. They refuse to look at the way they act or whatever it is they're having an issue with. And they refuse to say, look, this person makes me miserable. but that's what I know, and that's where I'm going to be. There's something about my ex that I just want to be with my ex. And it's that opportunity to work things out, talk about it. And when you're getting better and you're becoming healthy and strong, I say, like, you can feel a twinge when you pass the froggy pond, but you don't have to jump in. That's the Melody Beatty saying. And they're still jumping into the froggy pond. Like, they still want that, whatever it is, to work things out. And you're not giving them the opportunity to work their issues in childhood and relationships. And it's a pattern that people get into. And I remember I did a 4-part boundary podcast a while ago where I explained the relationship with my oldest brother and his wife. And I remember he bragged to my mother about ways that he acted like her. And my mother was telling me about this, and I was so confused. My mother was a lunatic, and when I was living with my brother when I was 17 and I was in a relationship with homicidal, I got thrown out of my house and I was all kinds of sick, and my brother scooped me up and brought me to his house, and then he was adopting a little boy and I was losing my room and my abandonment issues went crazy, and my brother wanted to build a room downstairs, but I was like, I'm going to Georgia with homicidal because I'm out of my mind. But when at the time when I was over at my brother's house, my brother would be talking about my mother and how crazy she was, throwing Thanksgiving turkey and knocking over the Christmas tree. And I did an article about my mother putting Huckleberry Hound in the trash can when I was like 5 years old and went to Mass. And our toys on Christmas morning, we didn't pick them up before we went to Mass. And we came home and our Christmas toys that we just got that day were in the garbage can. And Huckleberry Hound was like sticking out of the garbage can. I will never forget that. And I was coming home from church. I'm like 5 years old. I'm a foster kid and all my toys are destroyed. So my brother was telling my sister-in-law about all of this, and I don't remember what happened. I think it was because I was living with them and she didn't understand how crazy my mother was. So my brother just went nuts telling her all these crazy stories about my mother. And this whole thing was going on between them, between my brother and my sister-in-law and my sister and my mother. It was all nuts. So my brother had a problem with my mother's abuse at some point, and then every now and again he would go see her. He wouldn't call her on Mother's Day, wouldn't call her on Christmas. I mean, they were estranged. I talk about it the whole nine yards in that podcast. But every now and again, he'd show up and it was prodigal child come home. He would sit there and he would talk to my mother. It was old home week and it was so bizarre. And he told my mother at some point when she got sick, and I guess somebody called him and told him that she had gotten, I think it was her first bout of cancer. And somebody told she had cancer and see her. He went from New York. He's living in New York. He went up to see her. And he told her, he like bragged to her, which to me was nuts, that I don't know if I talked about this on the other podcast or not, but he told my mother that he had gotten into an argument with his wife. Now, they're practicing Catholic, so they didn't believe in divorce. But at some point, she was living in Schenectady, and that's way the hell up there. And I don't think he ever lived in Schenectady. I don't know what happened, but apparently they're back together. Or maybe she had to go up there to take care of somebody. I have no idea. But he told my mother that he had bought a living room set, a brand new set, and he had gotten into an argument with my sister-in-law. And he told my mother that he pulled the couch and the chair and the table and everything from the brand new living room set out onto the front lawn, and he took a hatchet to it and destroyed it all. And he was bragging to my mother about it because it was something that she would have done. And I heard that from my mother, and I was thinking about all he said in the year that I was living with him, how he complained about how abusive and crazy my mother was. And now he's bragging to her about chopping up the living room set, which is something she would have done. And I was like, oh my God, when you're in a relationship sometimes, and it's miserable, you're still working out your issues. I don't know what happened with my brother. I really don't. I mean, I know that he was angry at my mother that she still had pictures of the boy that they adopted. But the boy had lived with my mother at her house with his biological mother. And he was 5 years old when he was adopted. And I guess they went over to visit, and my brother was angry that there were pictures of the little boy when he was, and he would say, oh, I was here with my mommy, and my brother just went nuts, and my sister-in-law went nuts, and my sister-in-law never spoke to my mother or my sister again. It was this whole big thing that went on around the adoption. And my mother, my adoptive mother, was so manipulative to my birth mother. When my birth mother came to get me, she cried and she was all upset about my birth mother, and she didn't want to give him to it. And my birth mother was really upset and she left without me. And then my mother was upset that my brother didn't let the little boy's mother, who had lived with us, have her own lawyer. And I said the woman was Vietnamese, and she said that the Vietnamese believe that if you can't care for your child, and she was having a lot of trouble finding a job, and they believe that if you can't care for your child, you give them to somebody who can care for them. And with a very heavy heart, she agreed to the adoption. My brother and my sister-in-law couldn't have kids of their own, and they had a really nice house. My brother worked for the FDNY. He was studying for the lieutenant test when I was there, and he eventually became a captain as well. And the child was 5, and he grew up, and I'm sure that my brother had all this influence on him, because my nephew went into the armed services. He was in Desert Storm. He came out. He went to a 4-year college. He graduated, and then he went on the New York City Fire Department, the FDNY. And he played football in high school, the exact path my brother had taken. My brother was in the Army. He played football. He went to Vietnam. He came out. He was working for a moving company for a short period of time, and then he made the FDNY. And my nephew did exactly what my brother did. And my nephew wouldn't have done any of those things had he stayed with his mother. And I don't know how much influence my brother had, but went in the Marines, he was in Desert Storm, he saw combat, he came out, he got his degree, he went on the FDNY, got married, had a child. So much of his life paralleled my brother's, and I really don't know anything else about my nephew's life. It's not a terrible thing. My nephew's a success. My brother was a success. But there's all of these undercurrent of dysfunction that my brother had. I don't know about my nephew, but my brother has a lot of dysfunction, to stay with my crazy sister-in-law, to behave the way my mother behaved, and to have all these issues with my mother. And then my mother had all these issues with my brother and the adoption of my nephew, because the woman who was his birth mother was an absolutely lovely mother, unlike my birth mother. But I'm sure that my brother could absolutely convince himself that he was good for my nephew, that my nephew would have had a better life with them than he did with his birth mother. But his birth mother, she wasn't a lunatic like my brother, but I saw both my mother and my brother's adoption stuff, that they took completely different positions than they had when it came to me. Like, my mother was so angry at my brother, feeling that he manipulated my nephew's birth mother into giving up this child. And she was so angry with him about it. And my nephew's mother didn't get her own attorney. They used my brother's attorney. And when she came up a year later, because it was a trial period for a year, and when she came up to sign the adoption papers, the final adoption papers, she didn't want to. She didn't want to finalize the adoption. She was a mess. And she really didn't want to go through with it. And my mother kept saying to her, if you don't want to go through with it, don't go through with it. Which was the exact opposite of what she said to my birth mother, which was like, you can't come and take this kid now. And I was like, both my mother and my brother did these completely hypocritical things and no personal insight. In psychology, that's what we call them. When you do an evaluation and the person doesn't understand what it is about their behavior that's wrong or crazy, you write down no personal insight. When we had the DSM access code, which they did away with the DSM-5, but before that, when we did the access model, one of the things you wrote down was no personal insight. So neither my adoptive mother nor my adoptive brother had any personal insight because my mother was furious with my brother for doing exactly what she did to my birth mother. And I'm not saying that my birth mother was any sort of prize, because she wasn't. And I think about this all the time. You know, I wouldn't have had clean clothes and iron clothes. I wouldn't have gone to Catholic school. You know, a whole bunch of things I wouldn't have had had I gone to live with my birth mother as a child. She was very abusive towards my brothers. I don't know if she would have been abusive toward me. So it's really hard to figure out. I mean, it's like six of one, half dozen of another. Both my adoptive mother and my birth mother are crazy people. You know, my adoptive mother's borderline personality disorder, and I believe that my birth mother had narcissistic personality disorder. I mean, completely nuts, two of them. So which would be the frying pan and which would be the fire? Who the hell knows? But one thing that I hate my birth mother for, and even my adoptive mother, was that I didn't go to my older brother's family because they couldn't have their own children. They adopted a boy and a girl, my brother and a girl, who died of a brain tumor at the age of 10. And my brother said to me one time, my mother would have loved you. And when I heard those words, I just felt my heart breaking. To neither my birth mother nor my adoptive mother were loved. They just didn't. And, you know, so I think about the life I could have had if my birth mother would have just given me to the same people that had my brother. I mean, it would have been such a different life. It would have been so much better. And I'm still not over that. I mean, I pulled away from my entire birth family because they knew about my brother and they didn't tell me. And I would have loved to have known him, you know, when Michael, he's so much like Michael. And my kids said they met him and they said that he reminded them of Michael. You know, they rode Harleys, we rode Harleys, and yeah, it would have been great, but nobody was thinking about me. So anyway, none of these people. So my mother was so upset about my brother and the way he handled the adoption. And then it's like the way everybody handled my adoption was just outrageous. I mean, just completely outrageous. So people just don't have any personal insight. I mean, for my brother to spend months telling my sister-in-law how abusive my mother was. And then he goes up to my mother and he's bragging about the stuff that he did, which is completely nuts. I mean, who the hell chops up a brand new living room set just because you're angry at your spouse? I mean, that's crazy shit that went on in my adoptive family. And he's bragging about it. I'm like, no personal insight. I don't care. Like, yeah, you're a success. You're a veteran and you got the Bronze Star and you went to Vietnam and you became a lieutenant on the FDNY and then a captain on the FDNY. And yeah, you're fabulous. And your wife taught Sunday school and all this other stuff. And then you're chopping up the living room set. I mean, completely nuts, completely nuts. So anyway, there are some people that just want to continue to act out their childhood bullshit because they don't go to therapy. They don't think there's anything wrong with them. They have no personal insight. And the next thing you know, they're chopping up the couch on the lawn. It's ridiculous. You know, it's completely ridiculous. You have to think about people that have no personal insight. They're not reacting to you when they pull away. They're reacting to their own internal stuff that's not being taken care of, that they're not going to therapy, they're not reading books, they're not doing this, they're not doing that, they're just acting like a loon. And when they have so much fun with you and you're feeling like, oh my God, this is so fabulous, we click on all these levels, we're having such a great time, and then you're like, see ya, and you're like, wait, what the hell happened? It's not you, it's them. But you have to do the hard thing, which is when you're enjoying time with somebody who says, I have intimacy difficulties, or they start pulling away or something to that effect, you have to do the hard thing and walk away first. And I know from my clients are like, there's this guy, he's good looking, he's fun to be with, he's great, we click, when we're together, we have such a good time, he cares about me. And when they walk away or they do something where they say, like, I don't want to be in a crowd, I don't want to meet your friends or your family or whatever. Once those messages start coming through, you have to do the hard thing and walk away. Because nothing that you do to accommodate them and accommodate their difficulty or their disability is going to be good enough. Eventually, they're going to think you're just wonderful, and they're going to find themselves falling in love with you because, of course, they are, because you're fabulous. And they go, oh, my God, and they don't know what's going on. They're just completely uncomfortable, and they walk away. And you have no control over that, none at all. The only thing in control is to make a commitment to yourself that whenever you see the signs of a commitment phobe start coming up, you leave. And that's what I wound up doing after I was with this guy and another guy who was a bit of a commitment phobe. Any guy that would be with me and we were moving toward a relationship for a few months, and then there's always an expiration date with commitment phobes. There's always an expiration date. It usually could be 2 months, could be 3 months, 4 months, but it's definitely usually before 6 months. But any indication that I would get that somebody was a commitment phobe or somebody was still playing footsie with their ex or still had a thing for their ex or whatever, I would leave. I'd be like, no, I'm not doing that. And when you start to do that, as hard as it is, you will be strengthened by your ability to do that, to walk away from somebody who's so much fun that you click with, you know, is good looking and good shape, you know, this, that, another. Guy is the greatest thing since folded napkin, but he has commitment issues and I'm out of here. And when you make that commitment to yourself, you will just not put up with that anymore. For me, I had to go back and look at my relationship with my father, which is what I did, and that's how the father inventory, which is in Getting Past Your Breakup and in the workbook. And you might not have to do a father inventory or an ex-husband inventory, an ex-wife inventory, but once you start with the commitment phobes, you have to do acceptance statements. You have to accept that this guy or this woman is not the partner for you. And go to the affirmation workbook and do the acceptance statements. Do the even those statements and make a commitment to yourself that the minute somebody says something like, I've had intimacy difficulties, or they're playing footsie with their ex, or you get the impression that they are still in love with their ex or not over their ex or whatever it is, any indication, and it's still tangled up in your stuff, you need to leave. Make a commitment to yourself that you're leaving, as good as it feels and as hard as that is. When you're with this person, you have to get out. You have to let people know, I'm not putting up with this. And if you've been with abusive people, you've been with narcissists, you've been with the personality disorder, you have walked away from them. I know that these people are harder to walk away from. But I remember when I stood in the courtroom with my ex-husband, and I got the restraining order, and we had the trial, and he was going to subpoena everybody in my life and all of this stuff. And I stood up, and I was shaking like a leaf, and I detailed all the abuse, and I said, nobody's going to do this to me anymore. And the abusers fell away because I had made a commitment to myself. And I say that water seeks its own level. And I don't know how it works, but people know this is my issue, this is your issue, this is how our issues are going to play together. But once I resolved that, I would no longer put up with any abuse, not name calling, not verbal abuse, not emotional abuse, not physical abuse. I was never in a relationship with an abuser again, never. And I dated some guys and I was in a relationship with some guys and no one ever called me a name from the time that I got out of my relationship with my first husband to the day that Michael passed away. I mean, that was over 20 years. And any guy that I dated, I mean, and some of them didn't end very nicely, no one ever called me a name, no matter how angry any of them had gotten. And it was like, I just didn't date name callers. I mean, how do you know somebody is somebody who will call you a name? It's hard to tell, but I was never in a relationship with an abuser again. I was never in a relationship with anybody who called me a name again. I did my father inventory, and I also made the commitment that no matter how good it felt, if the guy I was with was not into me or pulled away or was still playing footsie with his ex or whatever, I was walking away. And the guy that I was with that I did the all the New England states with the lead. He was adorable. He was good looking. He was in good shape. The two of us working out at the same time. We talked a lot about gym stuff. We had a connection that was amazing. We laughed. We'd be in a crowd of people and somebody would say something. We'd look at each other like, you tell the jokes that were going on in our head. And even when we weren't side by side, we'd look across the room at each other and we'd just give each other those knowing looks. You would think you'd have to be together for years to get that kind of connection going. And we would have the same reaction. Some crazy thing would go on and, you know, we would be laughing. And I thought he was the most adorable person ever. And when I walked away from him, it was a commitment to myself that as great as this is, as great as he is, I'm not doing this anymore. As good of a time as I have with him, I'm not doing it anymore. And it was so hard to walk away. And you have to make a commitment that it's never going to feel as right as when you're with the personality disordered or the abusive people. Like, you know, you can look at them and you could say, oh my God, now that, you know, the blinders are off, I can see what they are. And oh my God, you know, you're running down the street like your hair is on fire. But with the commitment phobes, a lot more difficult because you're thinking, well, if they only did this or they only did that, they'd be perfect. But they don't do that and they're not perfect. When I gave up the commitment phobes, I was in a committed relationship for almost 5 years. And then I had a series of few losers. And then I met Michael. Each time I had to make a commitment to myself that I wasn't going to accommodate someone else's disability. And being unable to commit is a disability. If somebody can't be in a relationship because he or she has all these issues, stay away from them. Just make a decision that you're not going to accommodate them. If you call somebody and they're like, oh, you're suffocating me because you called them or you text them, that's not the relationship for you. You want to be able to be yourself in a relationship. And I always caution women that you've got to have your own life. You've got to let the guy know that you have hobbies, interests, friends, and you're an independent person, and you're not doing it just for show. You're not doing it so they don't feel suffocated, but it's a good thing to have. You have to make a commitment to yourself that you are great. You are wonderful. You are fabulous. I tell my clients this all the time. You want to be with somebody who sees how fabulous you are and that you are rare. And you don't want to be with somebody who's going to waste your time and to somebody who can't commit to someone as great as you. And that's what you have to do. You have to commit to yourself that you're not dealing with this anymore, no matter how great he is, no matter how good looking he is, no matter how this or that, no matter how much clip there is, you're not going to do it. Don't accommodate it. If you want to call somebody, you call somebody. You have to say, you can't say, oh, he's going to be like, oh, you know, she's chasing me. I can't call him. It's like, be yourself. You know, don't accommodate someone else's inability to commit because it's not going to help you. Accommodating them is not going to help you. It's just going to make you miserable. You've got to be true to yourself. You know, the saying is, to your own self be true or bullshit thyself not. So make sure you have hobby interest friends that you're not chasing them. But if you feel like calling them, call them. You know, and if he can't handle that, too freaking bad. But, you know, if you have questions about this, about commitment phobes or anything like that, send your questions to me. Send your questions to me about the Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial. I'm going to get a chance to listen to it, and I will put the Travis Alexander, Ryan Poston podcast link in the YouTube version of this podcast, and I'll talk to you guys later. Send me email and let me know what you want to hear, what you want me to talk about, any questions, any comments. Just send them to me, and hopefully we'll get this podcast back on a regular schedule, which I'm trying to do. So take care, everybody. This is Elliot, the Money Talking Podcast, signing off. Take care, all. Bye-bye.